Now I request Rakesh Dubbudu to share his point of view in this media, communications and climate change. Please, Rakesh.
Thank you, Dilip Reddy. Thank you for the kind words. Thank you for the speakers before me, and thank you for the speakers that are going to speak after me. Since there are people who have been working in the media for for decades now, and I limit my talk to in terms of the communication, what we have observed in other areas, how can we learn in terms of climate change and environment, and what are the issues that media itself could learn. So I limit myself to those instead of getting into repetitive mode of what others have spoken. So to begin with, so COVID-19 was probably the first pandemic of our era, in the sense most of us attending this call or speaking at this call, I'm sure during our lifetimes, this is the first big pandemic that we've seen, where apart from, since we work on misinformation, disinformation, colloquially called as fake news day in, day out, we came across something known as, a new emerging term called mid-information. So it is neither false nor true. So because the science is emerging, because the evidence is emerging, because things keep changing, when you do more research, when you hitherto unknown things. So mid-information is something like, misunderstandings, confusion based on inadequate or emerging evidence. And because of which we still try to say this could be possible without saying this is what will happen. And we saw a lot of it during COVID-19, whether with respect to cures, with respect to disease diagnosis, with respect to many other things, even vaccines, for instance, efficiency of vaccines. I see a very, very similar journey here, especially on the aspect of climate change, because as more research happens in terms of direct and indirect impact on humankind, on people, more at an individual level as well as at a societal level. And what kind of impact, it is not just an impact on environment or global warming or rains, etc., but it is closely intertwined with our daily lives. So a lot of research will emerge. I think one of the things that the media has to deal with is keeping its eyes and ears open, that a lot of what we are going to encounter, a lot of what we are going to read, report, is going to be mid-information, which is like, sometimes it could be half information, sometimes it could be emerging evidence, sometimes it could be where more research is needed. So given the experience of COVID-19 and reporting around COVID-19, I think this is a great example of how we can draw lessons from the reporting that we did, people did during COVID-19. I would basically talk about three broad things. One is how proper and understandable communication from media is going to be the key if we have to, especially within the theme of what media can do. Secondly, political accountability, of course, with respect to making them accountable for specific commitments, pushing political parties to include in their manifestos, like Purushottam Reddy garu was saying, and how we can inculcate the urgency of the issue of climate change right from the childhood. To begin with, in terms of communication, I think there is a great need now to clarify, to link to people's personal lives as to what climate change and global warming will do. Currently, it is, I believe it is a very elite academic esoteric issue, which a lot of people don't understand, or a lot of people don't identify with. They believe, whether it's a COP conference, whether it's what is written in papers, they still believe it is a very elite issue. I think there is a great need to communicate and tell people that it is not about limiting global warming at 1.5 degrees by 2030 or, pre-industry levels. It is much more than that. How does it affect a person individually? The moment we are able to do that, if we are able to communicate that clearly, a lot of awareness will come. And politically also, I think political accountability is internal, intertwined with what people know, what people demand. So as long as people know, people do not know, and people do not demand, I don't think political accountability will come just because we have, global conventions to follow. So for example, the use of firewood for cooking and all that, successfully a lot of women have realized that this is a very unhealthy practice, which has a direct impact on their health. So the shift to gas stoves, though it was slow, it happened. So I think there is a great need to take lessons from how communication campaigns were successful, especially with respect to how we were able to link it to their personal lives and how is it going to affect them in the long run and the short run. I think that will make a great difference in making it a political issue as well, not just an issue of being aware at a personal level, but also a political issue. So how do I know that climate change has to be at the top of the agenda when I don't even know that it is important? So I think that is one. And secondly, there is also a need, especially with both print, digital, and the new media, to make the entire understanding around climate change and global warming easy to understand, rather than make it very academic or esoteric. And you know, use yes, the terminology is important because it is what the globe understands. But at the same time, like Uma was saying, that make it short snippets, short bites. Make, you know, take it to their language rather than, you know, trying to communicated in language only few people understand. There is also a need for you know, dedicated coverage and slots, and which also brings to you know, the curriculum and journalism colleges, especially budding journalists who should identify these as special beats. Because at the end of the day, tomorrow, for example, how, because we work in fact checking has now become a specific, a very very specific skill. While 101 of journalism is fact checking, that you, before you write every story, you check for facts. But because of the way the society has changed, because of the way technology has transformed our lives in terms of consumption of information, now it has become a specialist beat where tools, technology also play an important role other than your own journalistic knowledge. I think in the same way, science and climate environment communication should also become a very, very important subject in journalism schools, where you know, budding journalists should pick this up, because this is going to be the future. Another thing that I strongly believe in, and not just with respect to climate change, but you know, also largely, is media should avoid the conflicting data points, especially in a very, very highly complex scientific issue like climate change. For example, you know, I'll take a very recent example. So Uma was also talking about you know, the paddy crop and the environmental impact of the paddy crop. So there was recently a study by, you know, a reputed organization, which you know, with a very good intention of letting people know that how paddy was unsustainable in the long run, you know, environmentally. There was one leading national daily which put up a headline, said 30 paddy crop in Telangana is, you know, emitting greenhouse gases equal to 30 crore vehicles. Now it's a very catchy headline, you know, it's a definitely a very important, very interesting way of catching people's attention. But the same story, same study, next day in another news daily, the number of vehicles was given equal to 2 crores. Now 30 crores and 2 crores is a very wide figure. Now people who have read those reports will start doubting the study itself. While the study, you know, study was talking about environment protection and how to make it a mainstream issue, these conflicting reports with mistakes in data, with no proper understanding of, so which is why I you know, before even communicating to people, I think there is a great need to educate newsrooms on what each one means. So what are greenhouse gases? What is CO2? What is the difference between these? What do we mean by emissions? So for example, the synthesis report that was released recently talks about the globe being, you know, may achieve only 13% of our 2030 targets, whereas to even reach our 2 degrees, you know, goal, we have to double it. The pace has to be doubled. Now, all these are very, very highly complex scientific issues, which I think there is a great need to educate the newsrooms. Otherwise, what will happen is these half reporting, mistakes in reporting will only sow more doubts in people and, you know, to lead to think of it as a global conspiracy to kind of put down certain countries or certain nations, which eventually happened in certain quarters in COVID-19, where people started feeling that it is a global conspiracy to kind of stop certain countries. And secondly, there is also a need to distinguish, the impact of climate change versus the impact of policy. So, or even both. So in some cases, it could be both. So especially during large scale floods, inundation in urban areas, cities like Hyderabad, Mumbai, and there is flooding. So, you know, there is always a linkage to how the global climate is changing because there are irregular rain patterns. But it is also a fact that a lot of it is also deeply because of policy failures. Now, you know, without trying to distinguish between both attributing everything to climate change or otherwise to policy failure. So trying to understand this puzzle and telling people that how both are in some ways interlinked, but are also very, very different in terms of while one may look like not in our hands, the other is very much in our hands in terms of in our own hand politics. So these have to be very, very clearly learned by newsrooms. Thirdly, though, in a way, we are lucky in countries like India, because unlike in the West, even if we saw that even during COVID-19, where these are deeply polarized groups about where they feel very strongly about certain things, they still feel COVID-19 is a conspiracy, like QAnon and other groups in the US, where they are strictly anti-vaccine or strictly they believe COVID-19 does not exist. We also see a lot of such things in the West, where you know, there is climate change denial, there is skepticism about the scientific community. There is also contrarianism that, you know, this is not real, this is just a farcical imagination. Thankfully, we don't have that in India so much, because partly because a lot of people don't consider that as a big issue, or because we don't have that such sustained moments where they're trying to discredit the whole thing and say this is a deep-rooted conspiracy. But at the same time, I think we are very, very close to a situation where this might become our problem as well, not a Western world problem, where we suddenly start believing in these deep conspiracy theories. In fact, Michael Mann, a well-known climatologist, and even The Guardian, very beautifully put down this, you know, the hierarchy of denials. So they start with, you know, it's called the six-stage denial, where they start with denying the problem itself, but towards the end they come and concede, yeah, it's too late, you know, the problem exists, but we can't do anything about it. So, for example, they start with saying CO2 is not actually increasing, so where they're in a way saying that they're denying the problem does not exist. But they also say, even, okay, assume it is true, but the increase will have no impact in climate science because there's no convincing evidence. So it is like the denial of consensus. Then comes deny that we are the cause. You know, even if there's warming, it is not due to natural causes. It is due to natural causes. It's not due to human activity. Then you deny it's a problem. But then you agree that there is warming, there is climate change, but you know, it is not a problem because the impact is going to be very minor. Then comes denying its effects. You deny the effects. You say the effects are very negligible. The changes are not have been happening to the Earth's atmosphere for so many millions of years, and you know, we have stayed, we have sustained. And finally, they come back to say, yes, all this is true, but it's too late. We can't do anything about it. Earth will find its own technological solution. I think, in a way, while this is a very Western construct, and I don't think it is true in the case of India, at least, very soon there will come a day where this will also happen, because as more and more distrust grows in politics between people, between groups, and you know, where you start judging people by the kind of ideology they profess, by the kind of things they support or oppose, I think we are going to see deeply polarized groups, even on issues where there should have been consensus. So whether it's climate change or COVID, this is not going to be just a Western problem, but in India, we're going to soon see. So I think the way forward is, like I told in the beginning, you know, three, four important, very important steps. To begin with is communicate. Unless we communicate it in the right language, we, in the sense, the larger media and the groups that are trying to make people aware, the language has to be very, very important. In a way, tell them it is a comprehensive problem. It is not one isolated issue related to increase in temperature or global warming or floods or something. But how is it deeply connected to what we are doing on a daily basis? You know, right from waking up to while we are going to sleep, you know, our travel, our work, our use of technology, you know, all these are in some ways either contributory factors or, you know, in some ways mitigating factors. So all of them have to be told, because at a personal level, unless we start doing something, we won't. So for example, the great awareness on climate change, I think today in India, at least in the urban setting, is with respect to vehicular pollution. So a lot of people thinking of starting on EV because there is you know, government subsidy, or starting to bicycle. All this is coming up, but again, this is a very isolated issue of vehicular pollution, while parallelly you do a lot of other things which compensate for the good things that you're doing. So that communication, I think, is a centerpiece, especially with respect to media, especially with respect to organizations that are in this whole realm of telling people or educating people on what is wrong, what is right. And secondly, even to broad base our support. I mean, at the end of the day, political parties, you know, even let's say in the 2024 Lok Sabha election, I don't think they'll automatically put all this in their manifesto unless there is broad-based support, unless they believe that people believe these issues are important. So only when that such broad-based support comes, so in a way, it is you can think of it as a very selfish motive, because the moment there is awareness, the moment it becomes a political issue, we are indirectly solving the problem, because then there is political commitment, then there is accountability because there is a commitment. So all of these are input. Then do not make it a retread, do not make it very academic or esoteric, trying to communicate something which is obviously scientific. You know, I'm not saying we should remove all the scientific terms, but also think of the language of, you know, what limiting factors, how does our communication limit or exclude certain people? Secondly, there is a great need to actively communicate, this and proactively educate people right from the childhood. So our school syllabuses need to change, where the discourse also needs to be about larger issues of climate change, which is again under the umbrella of environment. There is also a need for active discourse on multiple fora. So now, because with the advent of technology, at least, we have so many, we have avenues for discussion. While the utility and of those discussions is a different question altogether, but there is at least the availability of multiple avenues. I think those avenues have to be used to make this a centerpiece where each issue connected to the larger issue of environment and climate change need to be discussed. So active political societal discourse is the way to go, and also draw upon locals. So there could be a multitude of local solutions. In fact, the Indian government's response this year talks about, makes a mention of learning from local solutions, which is a good thing to do. But, unless it is implemented in action, what are those local solutions? How is it, linked to the larger issue? So overall, though we don't yet see a lot of misinformation or fake news around climate change as of today, but it is a very layered issue. It is not a straightforward issue of, unlike something else where you can say, okay, this is fake, this is not fake. This is a very layered, complex issue. So we might see the emergence of misinformation in quite complex forms in the future, especially with respect to denial, skepticism, or contrarianism that we are seeing in the West. We are not far away. So I think the time has come for us to come together, because as torchbearers of communication, right communication, I think it is on us. The first, in medical terms, to be called the first responders, or rather more than responding, I would say first proactive communicators. If we can do the communication bit well, I think we can definitely hope of solving the larger issue. Yeah, I'm done.
Thank you very much, Rakesh. You touched so many related subjects, and you gave a beautiful picture with integration. So many factors, and as you said, Western, like in the Western society, where that intentions behind that and manipulation. But here, for misinformation, there are so many factors. We cannot straight away suspect that sometimes it is inefficiency, sometimes it is ignorance, sometimes it is due to many factors. But that can be corrected easily, rather than the intended misinformation campaign, what's happening there. And even in these corporates who are playing vital roles today, even by minuting the governments, certain earlier we used to say multinationals, but now transnational corporations are coming, which is spread over in many countries, and their outlay, their annual budget itself is outnumbering the annual budget of some countries. In such context, thus industry is hiring sophisticated media technologies and strategies with PR for influencing and creating such a misinformation campaign. In this context, till yesterday, Brazil was saying that there is no climate change at all. In this scenario, what we are having, our problem is not so such big, and it can be corrected easily with small steps, as you said, by integrating different levels of knowledge at different platforms. That is the intention of Earth Center also, which is the initiation of CGR. We want to bring such all knowledge and integrate it for the benefit of that. As you said, right, that language should be a component, and the issue of a subject itself is an input. Unless you have clarity of thought, there will be no clarity of expression unless you have clarity of thought. Even among the media houses and reporters, they should have understanding proper the climate, what it is and where it is going, and what is the role as we are to play, and bringing that to the notice of the system of political. We incidentally, CGR made a demand for all political parties to announce the and incorporate in political manifesto that green assurances, green commitments, what you are going to. We went around by inviting MC Mehta, Professor Purushottam Reddy Garu, MC Mehta, and myself addressed a press conference in Delhi by asking all the leading political parties to incorporate in their manifesto the green agenda. So thank you very much, Rakesh. You brought it in a passionate way. Thank you.